This is Eric Strong from Stanford University, and today I'll be talking about vasculitis. After watching this video, you should be able to define vasculitis, describe typical features suggestive of vasculitis, describe the modern classification system of vasculitis, and most importantly, identify a probable vasculitis in a patient with a typical presentation. This video will not review the specific criteria of the individual forms of vasculitis. That's because this will take an hour to do, would be incredibly boring, and is unnecessary since the criteria is easy to look up when needed. Instead, I'll be focusing on vasculitis as a general category of disease, particularly how to recognize a patient who probably has vasculitis, since the varied multi-system presentations can be easy to confuse with other diseases. So first, what is vasculitis? Vasculitis is a diverse category of inflammatory diseases of the blood vessels. These diseases range in severity from self-limited dermatologic conditions to acute and rapidly fatal multi-system diseases. All forms of vasculitis are characterized by endothelial damage, intimal proliferation, thrombosis, and eventual vascular occlusion. Vasculitis can affect every organ system, typically in recognizable patterns based on the size of the affected vessels and the underlying pathologic mechanisms. So what do those recognizable patterns look like? The first layer of pattern recognition has to do with the size of the involved vessels and the knowledge that vasculitis tends to affect five organ systems the most, which are the skin, gastrointestinal system, kidneys, neurosystem, and the muscles. It can also affect the lungs, which I've left off here because it's not common, although when it does happen, its involvement is usually very prominent. When a patient has a vasculitis affecting the small blood vessels, he or she can get a skin condition called palpable purpura, which I'll show a picture of in a minute. GI involvement leads to mucositis and minor GI bleeding. The glomeruli of the kidneys are affected, which most commonly manifest as hematuria without red blood cell casts and proteinuria. Patients can get a polyneuropathy, and muscle involvement results in myalgias, which is a fancy word for muscle pain. A medium vessel vasculitis can result in two skin conditions called erythema nodosum and lividoverticularis. Patients can get abdominal pain and rarely bowel perforations. In the kidneys, damage is not limited to the glomeruli, so now there may be hematuria with RBC casts, along with flank pain from ischemia. In the brain, patients can get a wide variety of mental status changes, from somnolence to psychosis, along with strokes. And in the muscles, they get myositis, which differs from myalgias in that there is usually lab and pathologic evidence of muscle damage, such as an elevated creatine kinase. A large vessel vasculitis can result in cyanosis and discoloration of the extremities, bowel infarction, hypertension from involvement of the aorta or renal arteries, but no hematuria, strokes from involvement of the carotids, and claudication, which is pain in the extremities due to lack of blood flow. Unfortunately, the presentation of vasculitis is much more complicated than this because no one individual vasculitis disease leads to all the findings in any one column. There are, however, certain clinical features that are highly suggestive of vasculitis. The first is something called mononeuritis multiplex, which is a simultaneous or sequential dysfunction of individual, non-contiguous peripheral nerves in a seemingly random pattern. This typically presents as loss of sensory and/or motor function within individual nerves over days to weeks. For example, in this patient pictured, involvement of the ulnar nerve might result in weakness of the fourth and fifth fingers, involvement of the lateral cutaneous femoral nerve might result in paresthesias over the lateral thigh, and involvement of the common peroneal nerve could result in foot drop. In addition to vasculitis, other causes of mononeuritis multiplex include diabetes, HIV, and amyloidosis. Another feature that is highly suggestive of vasculitis occurs when an unknown multisystem disease has very prominent involvement of the lung and kidneys, especially the combination of pulmonary hemorrhage and either renal failure and or hematuria, as the only other non-vasculitis diagnosis that typically does this is anti-GBM antibody disease, also known as Good Pastures disease. Livedo-reticularis, which is a lace-like reddish to purple discoloration of the skin, is frequently seen in medium and occasionally small vessel vasculitis. It's certainly not pathognomonic, however, as an idiopathic form seen in young women is the most common etiology of this finding. Finally is palpable purpura, which is the development of numerous raised, non-blanching, purplish lesions on the skin, which are usually most prominent in the lower legs, ankles, and feet, as shown here. In addition to these four clinical features, there are a variety of other features which are less specific but are also commonly seen in vasculitis. They include headache, hypertension, pulmonary hemorrhage without renal involvement, abdominal pain, abnormal urinary sediment, a skin condition called erythema nodosum, which consists of multiple red tender nodules on the shins, arthralgias, and claudication. Here's a picture of erythema nodosum. Although I said that I wouldn't be reviewing the individual diagnostic criteria of the vasculitides, it's important to be familiar with their general classification scheme. Unfortunately, the classification of vasculitis is confusing and unsatisfying due to many reasons, including overlapping presentations, a mix of primary and secondary forms of vasculitis, evolving understanding of the underlying pathophysiologies, an evolving consensus regarding use of eponyms in disease names, and varied opinion on whether classification should be based primarily on the size of the affected vessels or on the underlying pathologic process. As a consequence, different sources may present slightly different classification schemes. The following classification is largely based on the most recent recommendations from the American College of Rheumatology. The first order division within vasculitis is based on the size of the target vessels. Large vessel vasculitides include Takayasu's arteritis, which predominantly affects the great vessels off of the aortic arch and has a predilection for young Asian women, and giant cell arteritis, also known as temporal arteritis, which primarily affects branches of the carotid arteries and which is seen almost exclusively among the elderly. Medium vessel vasculitis includes polyarteritis nodosa, which is the most widely distributed within the body of the vasculitides as it can affect any organ. Kawasaki disease affects almost solely young children and is best known for causing coronary artery aneurysms. And primary CNS vasculitis, infamous for mimicking all kinds of primary neurologic and psychiatric disease. Small vessel vasculitis is further subdivided into that which is associated with an autoantibody called anti-neutrophil cytoplasmic antibody, and that which is associated with immune complexes. ANCA-associated vasculitis includes three diseases with long and frustratingly similar names: granulomatosis with polyangiitis, which is a particularly dangerous vasculitis primarily affecting the kidneys, lungs, upper airway, nose, and eyes; eosinophilic granulomatosis with polyangiitis, which is characterized by the combination of asthma, sinus problems, neuropathy, and peripheral eosinophilia; and microscopic polyangiitis, which is clinically very similar to granulomatosis with polyangiitis, with the exception of a lack of upper airway involvement and a lack of granulomas on biopsy. The final category of immune complex associated vasculitis includes IgA vasculitis, a typically self-limited disease seen mostly in children, which is characterized by palpable purpura, abdominal pain, arthralgias, and renal involvement, usually limited to hematuria; cryoglobulinemic vasculitis, which is caused by antibodies called cryoglobulins, which precipitate when the temperature drops below body temperature. Most cases are triggered by chronic hepatitis C infection. And last, hypersensitivity vasculitis, which is usually limited to the skin, but can also cause fever, arthralgias, and diffuse lymphadenopathy. It can be triggered by medications, particularly penicillins and cephalosporins, along with a variety of chronic infections. A quick word about some of those names. Some types of vasculitis previously had different eponym-based names. For example, granulomatosis with polyangiitis was known as Wegener's granulomatosis until just a few years ago. Eosinophilic granulomatosis with polyangiitis was known as Churg-Strauss syndrome. And IgA vasculitis was known as Henoch-Schönlein purpura. In fact, most physicians still refer to these diseases by their eponyms, even if the scientific literature is shying away from them. Journals and professional societies aren't just changing the names for the sake of avoiding eponyms in general. Instead, Wegener's granulomatosis was named after Friedrich Wegener, who was a Nazi doctor who was speculated to have participated in experiments on concentration camp prisoners. But it seems that once one eponym was intentionally removed from the formal lexicon, all of the others are following. It seems likely that Takayasu's arteritis and Kawasaki disease will both be renamed in the near future. In addition to the types of primary vasculitis just listed, some systemic diseases can trigger a secondary vasculitis. For example, connective tissue diseases, malignancy, chronic infection, sarcoidosis, and Behçet's disease, the last of which is often considered a primary vasculitis itself. There are also many diseases which can mimic vasculitis, including DIC, Berger's disease, calciphylaxis, cholesterol emboli syndrome, anti-GBM antibody disease, bacterial endocarditis, and amyloidosis. Some sources actually list Berger's disease and anti-GBM antibody disease as true vasculitides, highlighting the overlapping and an incompletely understood pathophysiology of all of these disorders. So what are the general steps to diagnosing a vasculitis? First, the clinician must identify a collection of clinical findings which either suggest a vasculitis in general, or optimally, one or two specific vasculitides. Second, one should check routine labs, including coagulation tests and a urinalysis, and consider checking imaging studies and/or anti-neutrophil cytoplasmic antibodies. This will help to narrow down the differential diagnosis to one or two specific vasculitides, to search for an associated systemic illness that would make the vasculitis secondary, and to rule out vasculitis mimics. Finally, the diagnosis of a vasculitis should be confirmed, preferably with biopsy of a clinically affected organ and/or angiography. In the final minute, I'll very quickly review the basic treatment options for vasculitis, although you should keep in mind that each individual vasculitis may have specific treatment algorithms that this extremely brief overview may not capture. For limited cutaneous vasculitis, for example, mild IgA vasculitis or hypersensitivity vasculitis, sometimes observation and removal of offending agents are all that is necessary, though antihistamines and a short course of prednisone is often used. For mild systemic vasculitis, prednisone on the order of 0.5 to 1 mg per kilogram per day is common. Finally, for rapidly progressive and life-threatening vasculitis, prednisone plus a cytotoxic agent such as cyclophosphamide is the most common regimen. Cyclophosphamide can be transitioned to a less toxic agent such as azathioprine or methotrexate after remission is achieved.